संदीप जी, डॉक्टर ऋषि शुक्ला हैज जॉइन संदीप जी।
गुड इवनिंग
सर। गुड इवनिंग।
ओके, स्टिल 1 मिनट टू गो।
Yes, sir. We have Dr. Indranil here, sir.
Yes, yes. Hi, Dr. Indranil.
When the technical support Hello. Team has joined.
Hello, Dr. Shukla. How are you? We met in Jaipur last. Udaipur, yeah, yeah. Sorry. Udaipur Metaflammation.
All right. Yeah, yeah. You suggested to go to certain places. I remember.
Yes. Yes, yes, yes. Did you go there ultimately?
We did. We did. It was nice meeting
sir,
and
email, can we,
yeah, please go ahead.
Sorry sir, can yes. we just run through the slides sir once, just check that if the system and everything is proper.
Okay,
the technical team cool. is also check well, they will check the voice and video also sir.
Right, I have to minimize this.
No sir, you just have to take the cursor up. And next to the mic icon, you'll have the share screen icon in the center of your screen, sir.
Yes, it is there. It is there.
the first option, click here to start screen.
Yeah, I have located it.
Can minimize this and just one. Has it got stuck? You are opening the PPT because for us we can see only that your meeting is live.
No, I can see. He is searching for the PPT.
Yes.
He is Ipka. Okay. He has opened a folder. Now the meeting is opening. Now the PPT is opening. So you can, sir, you can put the slide on the desktop so it is easier for you to find out.
Yeah. I'll minimize this. I think then it will be also be easier. All done. Am I visible?
Yes, you're visible. Your presentation is full in presentation mode, so we can see it. Can you play one slide, just enter and see how the slides are running back and forth?
It is moving.
Yes. Yeah, they're moving very nicely. Yeah, network is good, I think. Network is very good.
Yeah. We have all become seasoned to... Yeah.
No, but sometimes what happens is the internet networks are very down. So then it doesn't move.
Right. I have to click right in case it doesn't move, or left.
Yes, right, or enter. You can put enter, then it go to the next slide. You enter back button, then you go to the slide before.
Right now it is not going.
Yeah, you can click on the screen and enter.
Screen and enter. No, it's not moving now.
It's not moving? you can take the cursor somewhere inside the presentation and then click enter.
Yes.
Click it. Now it's moving.
Yeah. It worked.
Yes.
All these tiny things. So
yeah.
I'm saving this and stop there. All right.
Yes. You become an expert, sir.
You taught so nicely.
Dr. Sharma is here.
Yeah, hello, Indrajit.
Hello, Dr. Sharma. Hello.
Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible, sir.
Very nicely audible and visible also.
Yes.
My voice is clear?
Yes.
But the voice from your side, I am not able to listen. Voice.
Can you hear now?
Yeah, I can, but the sound is quite less. His volume is quite less.
The voice is echoing.
Now, can you hear? Hello?
Yeah, I can hear. Should I try from a different laptop? Although the connection is okay. Indranil, how to share the screen? This is the button here, okay?
So, if you go to the top of the screen, in the middle top, you can see three. One is the camera icon, and then is the mic icon. After that, there is TV. Yeah. There is something like a TV screen. So, you can click on that to share screen.
Yes, sir.
So, if you click on the TV,
Is that
yes. Yes, correct. Now you can see the presentation. You can yes. We can see. Okay, just click next or enter, whatever it is. Yes.
Yeah.
So that's fine.
Now it is, sir.
Yes. Now it's fine, sir. So now you can stop sharing. Yes.
Her voice is coming a little low.
Can you hear my voice?
What was the voice? Hello?
As of now, I am doing the desktop.
Sir,
please be a little louder, sir. That's it, sir.
Hello?
I try to log in from the laptop also.
Sir, actually, there is a little disturbance which is coming. Sir, can you change your name?
Yes, sir, you can start now. Okay, sir. Yes. Yes.
So I'm trying to log in from a different laptop.
One. Sir, in that case, you please have to log out from this device.
Yeah, yeah.
Arvind, kaun hai Arvind?
Huh?
Arvind Sosal hai.
Haan. Arvind Sosal hai. Haan. Kya ho gaya? Arvind Sosal hai toh hai. नहीं स्लाइड तो
ये तो बंद कर दीजिए सॉफ्टवेयर बंद कर दिया था
हाँ अच्छा चल रहा हूँ बोल रहे हैं ना अरविंद कश्यप नहीं है क्या
अरविंद कश्यप है तो म्यूट करके बैठा
दिख रहा है ना ठीक हाँ मैडम क्या हुआ
हेलो आंटी सभी का दिख रहा हूँ लेआउट चेंज हो गया है बना रहे अभी बहुत दिन से लॉग इन किया होगा तो सब दिख रहा है राजन पॉल अरविंद कश्यप
अभी अभी ठीक हो गया अभी ठीक हो गया मैडम वो बीच में जब ट्रांजिशन होता है ना तब वो अभी 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 आ जाएगा 30 सेकंड वेट करिए आ जाएगा अभी आ गया होगा मैं करवा देता हूँ उनका आ गया मैडम 30 सेकंड लगता है वो सेट करने में ठीक है सर वन डॉक्टर बलराम वन मिनट सर देर इज अ लॉट ऑफ नॉइस विच इज कमिंग फ्रॉम द बैक
Some music is coming now.
How is this?
What is this? This? Some music is. हेलो एक क्या भजन टाइप क्या आ रहा है
हेलो डॉक्टर पारे, डॉक्टर पुरकित,
यस,
अभी डॉक्टर बलराम को दोबारा ज्वाइन कराना पड़ेगा.
डॉक्टर रसोले जी को स्पीकर रखना है. डॉक्टर अरविंद, डॉक्टर अरविंद, यस डॉक्टर अरविंद, सो हिज सिग्नल आर ड्रॉपिंग, नॉट वेरी गुड ग्रेट, सो इट इज गोइंग ओके राइट नाउ, बट इन केस इफ इट ड्रॉप्स वी माइट हैव टू स्विच टू गैलरी फॉर फ्यू सेकंड्स. इट आई एम जस्ट अपडेटिंग.
या डॉक्टर बलराम, इट इज नाउ परफेक्ट सर, परफेक्ट.
सो विद दिस डिवाइस आल्सो आई कैन ट्राई टू शेयर द
स्क्रीन.
Is this okay?
हाँ सर, प्रेजेंटेशन आ रहा है सर, बट थोड़ा, हाँ अभी अभी ठीक है सर. सर आप हेडफोन यूज कर सकते हैं सर, क्योंकि सर, अच्छा हेडफोन पे है, फिर भी पता नहीं नॉइस ले रहा है अगर बगल.
नहीं, हेडफोन पे ही हूँ.
अच्छा ठीक है, वी विल रिजॉल्व दिस. प्रेजेंटेशन को सर फुल स्क्रीन में प्ले करेंगे एक बार.
ओके ओके, आप कैसे देखिए.
हाँ सर बराबर है, रन कपल ऑफ स्लाइड सर, दो तीन स्लाइड रन कर दीजिए. फुल स्क्रीन कर दो इसका. यस सर ठीक है.
ठीक है सर, ठीक
है. सर समटाइम्स व्हाट इज हैपनिंग सर, अगर स्लाइड स्टक हो जाता है तो यू कैन एक्चुअली डू द राइट क्लिक एंड नेक्स्ट बटन दबा दीजिए. डॉक्टर मोहन, गुड इवनिंग सर.
गुड इवनिंग
सर, कैन वी डू द स्क्रीन शेयरिंग प्लीज.
लेट अस डू द स्क्रीन शेयरिंग.
या
नाउ शेयर माइक्रोसॉफ्ट वर्ड, गूगल क्रोम.
नो नो सर, सबसे ऊपर वाला क्लिक हेयर टू स्टार्ट शेयरिंग स्क्रीन आता है सर, सबसे ऊपर, उसके भी ऊपर रहता है. हाँ सर, ये मिनिमाइज कर दीजिएगा, मिनिमाइज कर दीजिएगा.
नहीं आप इसको मिनिमाइज कर दें.
नहीं नहीं, अभी आपने स्क्रीन शेयर किया था सर, उसको शेयर कर दीजिए दोबारा.
नहीं अब मैं, दिस इज नाउ आई एम प्रेसिंग ऑन स्क्रीन शेयर.
हाँ सर प्लीज डू इट.
नो आई एम नॉट, नथिंग न्यू अबाउट इट, यू आर
कौन
लिखता
है. ये वाले में आ जाओ, वो डॉक्टर को जरा रिजॉल्व करना है.
टू स्क्रीन टू शेयर.
पांच मिनट रह गए हैं यार, कुछ करो जिसको खत्म करें.
शॉर्ट फॉर सम टाइम.
नो नो, आई विल बी देयर थ्रू आउट द रैंक, बट व्हाट इज प्रॉब्लम, आई जस्ट फिनिश 2 hours ऑफ वेबिनार ऑन टॉप and now we are not able to even do the screen share. What is wrong actually? Just, why don't you tell me actually what is wrong?
Sandeep ji.
Sandeep ji.
Sir, it is just choose screen to share the first option.
Choose screen to share.
जब आप शेयर
करेंगे ना सर, इट सेज शेयर स्क्रीन, सो आई एम प्रेसिंग द शेयर स्क्रीन एंड इट गिव्स मी फोर ऑप्शंस
सर, चूज द
सॉफ्ट वर्ड
सर, चूज स्क्रीन स्क्रीन टू शेयर, यू हैव टू सिलेक्ट चूज स्क्रीन टू शेयर,
सर कैन यू जस्ट क्लिक द शेयर स्क्रीन प्लीज, ये तो पीपीटी सिलेक्ट कर लीजिए सर,
स्लाइड्स,
हाँ सर स्क्रीन शेयर करिए सर, एक बार स्क्रीन शेयर नहीं हुआ अभी आपका, हेलो
नहीं नो इट इज स्क्रीन शेयर एक्चुअली, आई कैन सी माई सेल्फ, आई कैन,
हाँ सर अब हो रहा है सर,
स्लाइड्स
सर अभी स्क्रीन शेयर हो रहा है आपका, हाँ सर वी आर जस्ट
यू कैन सी
द, या हाँ सर अब आया आपका स्क्रीन, अब दिख रहा है, आप पीपीटी ओपन कर दीजिए सर, अभी आपका
पीपीटी ओपन,
आपका डेस्कटॉप दिख रहा है सर,
हाँ जी ये पीपीटी ओपन है भाई, चल रहा है,
वन मिनट सर, हाँ सर आ गया, हार्ट फेल्योर इन इंडिया, जेसी मोहन, एपिडेमोलॉजी इश्यूज एंड चैलेंजेस, या सर, सर एक दो स्लाइड मूव कर देंगे,
अब मूव किया मैंने, देखा आपको,
हाँ सर थोड़ा सा टाइम लैग आ रहा है, स्लाइड अभी मूव नहीं हुआ सर, देयर इज सम टाइम लैग विच इज कमिंग,
नो आई एम ऑलरेडी ऑन 7th 8th स्लाइड,
लाइफ टाइम रिस्क ऑफ HF 20%, HF इज अ मैलिग्नेंट, अब तेजी से
नहीं, चेंजेस नहीं कर रहा, आप देखिए अब आया,
हाँ प्रेवलेंस, हाँ आया सर, HF न्यूरो ह्यूमरल रैली मीडिएटेड क्लिनिकल सिंड्रोम ऑफ एफर्ट इस्केमिक कोरोनरी 60%, अभी दिख रहा है सर वो,
ओके ओके दैट,
हाँ सर वो कई बार सर थोड़ा सा लैग रहता है आपके क्लिक करने में यहाँ आने में, तो दैट इज देयर,
नो प्रॉब्लम,
कुछ होगा तो हम लोग बता देंगे सर,
ओके ओके ओके
ठीक है, डॉक्टर इंद्रनील, डॉक्टर इंद्रनील कौन लिख रहा है, हाँ उसका शार्दुल क्या कर रहा है यार, वैशाली का अटक रहा है क्या,
बहुत ज्यादा, और वो अरविंद कश्यप लिख रहा था कि इसको लाने के लिए,
भैया इसका शुरू करा दो अभी कार्डियोलॉजी वाले का,
so Dr. Mohan you will be there throughout the length of the program, hello Dr. Mohan can you hear me,
yes I will be there throughout the length,
okay okay, yeah, so then should we do the questions,
yes,
after
you,
the
I
presentation
will be there throughout,
okay,
I no, have no problem. Question
okay,
no, I my have question no problem. Is any which way you want to do I have no problem,
okay thank you sir, thank you,
इंद्रनील यू कैन पुट अप योर स्लाइड एंड हु इज द फर्स्ट स्पीकर सर, डॉक्टर इंद्रनील ठीक है, ओके ग्रेट ठीक है, सो यू कैन पुट अप योर स्लाइड, आई एम जस्ट स्टार्टिंग द वेबकास्ट, गिव मी टू मिनट्स,
जस्ट यू जस्ट यस,
Sir, you can start now.
Okay.
Okay.
Good evening, everybody.
Good evening, everybody.
There's an echo, Sandeep ji. Hello. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to Experts Outlook live webinar series. I am Dr. Indranil Purkai, General Manager, Medical Services, IPCA Laboratories, the moderator for today's program. We have a wonderful agenda for today, a wonderful webinar designed basing on three different aspects. One is on heart failure, second is on lipid management in diabetes, and third is on type 2 diabetes management, hypoglycemia. So we have three eminent speakers who will speak on these three topics. So let us introduce your speakers one by one. First, I would like to welcome and introduce Dr. Professor J.C. Mohan. He is an MD in internal medicine, DM in cardiology, member of National Academy of Medical Sciences, and also a fellow of Indian Academy of Echocardiography since 2002. He is currently chairman, Institute of Heart and Vascular Diseases, Jaipur Golden Hospital, New Delhi, and earlier, director of cardiac sciences, Fortis Hospital. He's the chief of cardiology at Jaipur Hospital previously as well, Sundar Lal Jain Hospital, Metro Heart Hospital, and Saurabh Hospital and Health Institute. He has been a faculty for research presentations for more than 35 international conferences and former professor of cardiology at G.B. Pant Hospital and Maulana Azad Medical College Hospital. He served as a president of Faculty Association of the G.B. Pant Hospital, president of IAE and president of CSI and vice president of CSI. And currently, he is the president of Apex Society for CME in Cardiology. He has been a member of National Academy of Medical Sciences, member of American Society of Echocardiography, an honorary fellow since 2013, and also fellow of Indian Academy of Echocardiography and fellow of Geriatric Society of India. He has been the editor of the Journal of Indian Academy of Echocardiography and publisher of Indian Heart Journal and Index Journal of Cardiovascular Medicine. Contributed more than 250 original research publications in Index National International Journals. An author of textbook on echocardiography titled A Practical Approach to Clinical Echocardiography. Currently also president of Indian Society of Interventional Cardiology. He has been bestowed with honorary fellowship of the American Society of Echo, the only Indian to receive this honor. I welcome Dr. Professor J.C. Mohan to today's program. Next, I would like to welcome and introduce Dr. Rishi Shukla. He is an MD in Internal Medicine, DM in Endocrinology, Head of Department of Endocrinology at Regency Healthcare Kanpur, and Consultant and Owner of Center for Diabetes and Endocrine Disease in Kanpur as well. He has numerous publications, international and national journals, and also presentations and deliberations. His areas of interest include diabetes education and social issues and type 1 diabetes, and presentations at Internal Society for Pediatric and Adolescent Diabetes, IDF, RSSDI, and also Diabetes India. He's been invited faculty in ESAD, ISPAD, and also invited faculty at ESI, RSSDI, and various national organizations. He's contributed in books. One of his textbooks of cardiac endocrinology by ESI, Sadikot textbook, Changing Diabetes in Children, and also RSSDI Insulin Monogram. He's running regular patient education programs for the last 25 years by the organization Society for Prevention and Awareness of Diabetes in the Kanpur. He's been a recipient of recognition award in economic types in 2018. Welcome Dr. Rishi Shukla to today's program, please. Next, I would like to welcome and introduce Dr. Balram Sharma. He's an MD in Indian Medicine, DM in Cardiology, Associate Professor and Consultant Endocrinologist, and also specializing in diabetes, thyroid, and hormone disorders. He is currently Associate Professor, Consultant in SMS Medical College and Hospital, Jaipur. He has been a postgraduate teacher and examiner for DM Endocrinology course, has more than 20 national and international publications, speaker at various national and regional level scientific conferences, also a member of American Endocrine Society, European Society of Endocrinology, and AACES. He is a life member of Endocrine Society, ESI, RSSDI, Indian Thyroid Society, API, and ISBMR. He is a president, is a recipient of A.V. Gandhi Award for Excellence in Endocrinology. He has had all the best publication award, IRTMS, Rajasthan Epicon, Channa Reddy Award, Excellence in Endocrinology Award for Extraordinary Performance by Rajasthan Medical Council. He has also excelled in Endocrinology Award by Allen Group and 94.3 My FM Group, and also Outstanding Faculty Award by SMS Medical College. So he's new owner of various and numerous awards. I welcome Dr. Balram Sharma to today's program. Next, I would like to take you through the agenda. So we have the first topic, which is topic number one, heart failure in India, issues and challenges. The speaker is Dr. Jesse Mohan. The topic number two is lipid management in diabetes. Our speaker is Dr. Ishi Shukla. Topic number three, hypoglycemia in type 2 diabetes. Our speaker is Dr. Balram Sharma. And next, we will have a definite panel discussion where different questions will be asked to the panelist, and also we'll take some questions from the audience. With that, I would like to hand over the podium to Dr. Professor J.C. Mohan for the first presentation, Heart Failure in India, Issues and Challenges.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I am going to take you through the epidemiology, issues and challenges facing patients with heart failure in India. I know that this is a varied group with heterogeneity, and I am going to keep the talk as simple as possible. However, it is heart failure is a major public health problem, and lifetime risk of developing heart failure is 1 in 5. So each of us should be interested in heart failure. Okay, sorry. So heart failure is the epidemic of this century, and it shares this space in India with atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, diabetes, CKD, and hypertension. Heart failure is also a malignant disease. Data from Trivandrum Heart Failure Registry published 2 years back suggests that 3-year mortality of heart failure is 41 to 46%, depending upon the phenotype, and this mortality is higher than most of the malignancies which we encounter. Prevalence of heart failure in the world is 1 to 3%. We do not have exact data from India, but let us believe the prevalence is about 1%. However, what is clear is because of multiple risk factors which are prevalent in the society, lifetime risk of heart failure is 20%. So what is heart failure? Heart failure is a neurohumorally mediated clinical syndrome of effort intolerance, which means anybody who complains of shortness of breath on walking, fatigue on walking or routine activity, or is complains of weakness, one of the things which should come to your mind is this person suffering from heart failure? So symptom of effort intolerance in the form of dyspnea, weakness, fatigue, or maybe excessive sweating, and inability to carry out routine activities. Signs of heart failure are well known. These could be basal crabs, third heart sound, JVP, hepatomegaly, pedal edema, and so on and so forth. However, what is important when you have these clinical symptoms and you want to diagnose heart failure, there should be some structural alterations in the heart which you should be able to pick up with the help of X-ray and echocardiogram. So these are good enough that there is a structural alteration in the heart and patient is probably suffering from heart failure. However, pressure around 10 millimeter mercury. By heart failure, filling pressures are elevated, and in case you can't see JVP, you can't hear third sound, you can't look aroused, which are the signs of elevated filling pressure, you measure natriuretic peptides, BNP or NT-proBNP, which are the surrogates for elevated filling pressure. And if the BNP is above 35 picogram or NT-proBNP is above 120 picogram, it is likely these symptoms represent heart failure. The three important etiologies of heart failure are ischemic, about 60%. That means coronary artery disease, myocardial, which is 30%, which includes actually diabetes, hypertension, dilated cardiomyopathy, endocrinopathies like hypothyroidism, hypovitaminosis, hyperparathyroidism, so and so forth. And then, even now, world over, including India, valvular heart disease accounts for 10 to 15% of heart failure. In India, it is rheumatic heart disease more often. In the Western world, it is degenerative valvular disease, either aortic stenosis or mitral regurgitation. So how do patients present? As I said, mostly these people have some or the other risk factor, coronary artery disease, diabetes, hypertension, aging, CKD, myocarditis, connective tissue disease, and when the heart fails and filling pressures get elevated, they can complain of dyspnea or fatigue of cardiac origin. So let us look at the facts and figures. If we believe that the 1% of the adult population in India has heart failure, although worldwide figure is median of 2%, then there are 10 million patients with heart failure in India. To this are added 2 million annually. Annual mortality is 20 to 25%. Most of our patients have what is called heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. But keep in mind that heart failure has two components. There has to be a substrate, which could be systolic dysfunction, diastolic dysfunction, or left ventricle aortic decoupling because of hypertension. And there is another reason for heart failure to manifest, that is trigger. And trigger could be infection, arrhythmia, ischemia, drugs, water load, anemia. So there are some triggers which will actually push these relatively asymptomatic people to symptoms of effort intolerance. There are distinct phenotypes of heart failure. For a long time, we thought there were only two phenotypes, heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, where the ejection fraction was more than 50%, and heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, where ejection fraction was less than 40%. Of late, a middle child has been added called heart failure with mid-range ejection fraction, and the ejection fraction rate is 40 to 49%, but patients have classic symptoms and signs of heart failure. This is called heart failure with mid-range ejection fraction. We just few months back published our own data, and we showed that 77% of the patients which are admitted to the hospital have heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. 12% have mid-range ejection fraction, and 11% have heart failure with reduced preserved ejection fraction. Remember, the data from low and middle income countries published in Inter-CHF says that heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, which was the combination of HFpEF plus heart failure mid-range ejection fraction, is 29%. Our figures are very, very similar. So let me show you how we differ from Western world. And this is a bimodal distribution of ejection fraction heart failure, 50% being at the center. So in the Western world, 50% of the heart failure is heart failure with preserved ejection fraction on your right, and 50% is with heart failure with reduced ejection fraction on your left. But in India, the curve actually shifts to the left, which means we have far fewer patients with heart failure and ejection fraction more than 50%. Most of our patients are those who have heart failure with ejection fraction less than 50%. It has been because the two are treated in a different way and two have different prognosis, and there are disease modifying agents available for HFrEF. There are no disease modifying agents available for heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. So basically, heart failure with reduced ejection fraction is characterized by loss of cardiomyocytes, while heart failure with preserved ejection fraction is characterized by stiffening of cardiomyocytes. These myocytes are thicker, these are relaxing less, and these are hypertrophied. Put it the other way, why it is so important? Because in HFrEF, disease modification is possible. You can improve the ejection fraction, you can decrease the size of atrium and ventricle, HFpEF, you do not have any disease modification, and you only provide symptomatic treatment, although both types of heart failure have similar prognosis in long term. Heart failure with preserved ejection fraction has three different phenotypes in this country, and the most sinister of that is phenotype phenogroup 3, which is a cardiorenal syndrome, patients having chronic kidney disease, elderly people, and those who have highest BNP. The one which has the best prognosis is relatively younger people with low BNP, is phenogroup 1, and these are typically individuals who have hypertension or females less and who are actually short of breath on. And the phenogroup 2 falls in between, it is a metabolic ischemic group. Okay. Heart failure with preserved ejection fraction is heterogeneous, has heterogeneous mechanisms. It is characterized by depressed reserve capacity involving multiple domains of cardiovascular function. So these are people who are usually females with the elderly individuals with atrial fibrillation, chronic kidney disease, hypertension, sleep apnea, anemia, and usually when you study the physiology, you will find that these patients have stiff left ventricle or stiff left atrium or stiff aorta or impaired coronary. We would not go in more details of heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. This in itself is a big subject. Nevertheless, we are talking about issues and challenges. So our issue is when heart failure is characterized by high mortality, recurrent hospitalization, and poor quality of life. These are the three cardinal features of heart failure. So, but luckily, we have been able to improve the life expectancy of heart failure with guideline directed medical therapy. Very recent meta-analysis published just 6 weeks back in Lancet suggests that if these are younger people with heart failure, we have been able to add about 6.5 years to their life. But if they are very old people, we still add 1.5 years to their life. So we have been able to prolong life of the heart failure patients with current guideline directed medical therapy. Usually symptomatic treatment consists of taking care of venous congestion, extracellular congestion, and arterial hypoperfusion. And remember, multi-organ hypoperfusion produces multi-organ dysfunction. So worsening heart failure later is characterized by disease of kidney, liver, lungs, and so on and so forth. So how do we treat heart failure? We reduce ejection fraction. I told you there is a definitive therapy. Disease modifications are available. And the 2020, as of June 2020, not July 2020, the guidelines are there are five groups of drugs and the fifth is devices. So you have anti-RAS agents, beta blockers, mineralocorticoid receptor antagonists, SGLT2 inhibitors which have been approved by the DCGI only last month, and devices. Devices are ICD or CRT to improve function or to prevent sudden death. But there are drugs which are not disease modifying, but they improve the symptoms, like diuretics, digitalis, evobradin, iron, intravenous iron, nitrates, hydralazine, coenzyme Q, and so on and so forth. But we would be talking about only disease modifying agents as of today, because these change the prognosis of these individuals. It is necessary to initiate and uptitrate disease modifying agents as early as possible, as early as you diagnose. And I told you there are four classes of disease modifying agents: ACE inhibitors, beta blockers, mineralocorticoid receptor antagonists, and now SGLT2 inhibitors. There is another thing which we have to remember. These patients pass through a stage of stability and instability. When they are stable, we call it ambulatory or chronic heart failure. When they get decompensated, we call it acute heart failure, which can be de novo or actually acute decompensation. And I told you heart failure is a malignant disease, and data from India suggests annual mortality of 16%. The data from India also suggests that unlike Western world where coronary artery disease accounts for 55% of heart failure, in India, coronary artery disease or ischemic etiology accounts for 70% of heart failure. And this is evidenced by three studies from India, from Vijay Chopra from Medanta, our study from Fortis and Trivandrum Heart Failure Registry. Data from the Asian Heart Failure Registry also suggests that compared to Chinese, the heart failure in Indians have more often coronary artery disease. Of course, Malays are ahead of us as well. What is the role of hypertension? Although ischemia produces heart failure, but the contributing factor, the biggest contributing factor is hypertension. Population attributable risk of hypertension is 50%, but if the patients are above the age of 65 years, then PAR is 68% as far as hypertension is concerned. So hypertension contributes to 2/3 of heart failure in elderly individuals. So what are our concerns? What are the patient's concerns as far as heart failure is concerned? Physician is concerned about reducing mortality and reducing hospitalization. Patient is concerned for at the bottom. Symptoms and quality of life should be better. Hemodynamic function should be better. Then patient is also concerned about reduced hospitalization. And mortality is something which actually we never talk of, but physician's main concern, they are obsessed with reducing mortality, which is a good thing, but not at the cost of symptoms. Also, the difference, let's look at the top of the pyramid more often. Physicians look at the bottom of the pyramid more often. But for patient, both top and base of the pyramid are important. Why is heart failure that common in India? 1% probably is an underestimate, because risk factors which cause heart failure are very much prevalent in India. Ischemic heart is in 10% adult population, hypertension in 30%, CKD in 5%, and we have diabetes in 8% entire population. And remember, our population is aging and putting on weight. All those things which increase the neuromodal activations, RAS and synthetic neuromodal activation, and predispose to heart failure. The stage B of heart failure is people who have evidence of structural alteration of the heart without symptoms and signs. And these things can be left ventricle hypertrophy, low ejection fraction, diastolic dysfunction, or subclinical dysfunction not obvious, like global longitudinal strain. It has been estimated, again guesstimated, that 100 million Indians have stage B heart failure, of which about 20 million have what we call stage C and D heart failure, or symptomatic manifest heart failure. Let us look at how do we achieve this figure? There are 900 million adults in the country. If we think 1% is the prevalence of heart failure, we should have 9 million adults with heart failure. We look at diabetes, we have 77 million individuals with diabetes in India. That is the IDF data 2019. And 10% heart failure, 10% diabetics have definite heart failure. The figure varies from 9 to 22%. By that logic, 8 million heart failure patients, diabetic patients would have heart failure. If you actually do a least estimate method by CKD, then again we would have about 7.5 million people with heart failure. And remember, CKD is not that prevalent, so there must be individuals who don't have CKD. And you can easily estimate 15 to 20 million Indians have heart failure, nearly 40-50% of them with diabetes, nearly 35-40% of them with CKD, and others without these two conditions. Data from India, again, which we have also published and other two groups have also published. So there are four studies. The, of the 2019 and 2023 studies are at the bottom. The prevalence of diabetes is 49 to 61% in heart failure. That is a very big figure. And this figure is almost twice of what is reported in the Western literature. Acute and compensated heart failure, I talked to you, and this is our own data published 2 months back. diabetes present in 61%, hypertension in 54%, CKD in about 29%. 1 year mortality, there is a confusion of registries as far as Indian data is concerned. Various registries have shown mortality, varying annual mortality of 8 to 38% with a mean of about 20%. In hospital mortality in acute decompensated heart failure in India, the first three studies, including our study, shown 8.5%, but there are two studies which are outliers have shown mortality as high as 30% within the hospital. What are the variations? Why variations in mortality between regions? This could be because of healthcare infrastructure, quality and access, environmental and genetic factors. But remember, you can never reduce the mortality of heart failure to zero. More so of patients with HFpEF, because non-cardiac mortality accounts for a substantial mortality in these individuals. So what are the issues in India? We don't use, actually we don't use directed medical therapy. We use, even if we use low dose, we do poor titration, and patients have low adherence to guideline-directed medical therapy. Part of the reason could be money, part could be lack of education. And Trivandrum Heart Failure Registry, I already told you the readmission rate is 30% 1 year, which is pretty high. And inter-CHF study, again, in fact, 23% of mortality from India was 1 year mortality was pretty high. I will skip this, but I just want to tell you that we exactly don't know what is the 1 year mortality in India. The two studies I have quoted here show a three times variation in India and two times variation in China, which tells you what goes in decides what is the mortality. But in general, mortality is closer to 20% than closer to 10%. Management of heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. You do detection and adequate treatment of comorbidities, and diuretics are the mainstay of treatment. What about heart failure with reduced ejection fraction? I already told you the foundational pillars are anti-RAS agents, beta blockers, MRA, SGLT2 inhibitors, and devices. The heart failure with reduced ejection, even newer drugs, including dapagliflozin and ARNI, have also made a 50% further reduction in mortality compared to A plus B. A stands for anti-RAS agent and B stands for beta blockers. So from A to A plus B also we have gone further. What is the used therapy in India? These are two again studies, Asian Heart Failure Inter-CHF study. The use of ACE inhibitors, beta blockers and MRA in India is suboptimal.
It recording is has started.
Somewhere around 60 to 50%. And of course, this is our study again showing that the all three drugs are used uncommonly. At discharge from Trivandrum Heart Failure Registry, the use wasn't more than 50% of life-saving drugs. This is the largest registry from India called Pinnacle Registry, and it shows that anti-RAS agents are used in 35%, beta block in 34%, A plus B only in 30% patients with HFrEF in India. So there is underuses and underdosing of therapy in India, and recommended doses actually in Asian heart failure used in low 20s in fact. And of course, device use in India is still dismal. It is less than 2%. In USA, it is 35%. In Europe, it is about 16%. So, ladies and gentlemen, to summarize, it is going to require resources to take heart failure, to take failure out of heart failure. It is going to require vision and is going to require cooperation of multiple specialists. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Mohan, for your wonderful presentation. So, we will take a couple of questions now, and then we will come back to you again during the panel discussion. So, a couple of questions for Dr. Mohan. So, first question is that what are the tests which are most important in the initial evaluation for suspected heart failure?
So, you do four things need to be done. Clinical examination is the single most important. History and clinical examination, ECG, chest X-ray, echocardiogram, and measure BNP. These are the only things which are required to diagnose heart failure. 95% time, these are good enough.
Yes. And is there a role of genetic testing also in the diagnosis of heart failure?
So genetic testing is done for genetic dilated cardiomyopathy. Non-ischemic cardiomyopathy accounts for or one third of heart failure. Of that, one third is genetic cardiomyopathy. And these individuals may require, usually if there is a family history, you should be doing genetic marking. People who have non-ischemic cardiomyopathy, younger individuals where echo gives this picture that it may be genetic, it can be mitochondrial myopathy, non-compaction of the left ventricle, arrhythmogenic right ventricle dysplasia, Duchenne type of muscular dystrophy, you should be doing genetic testing in these individuals.
So in India, if you talk about the etiology and the comorbidity, we know about heart failure, we know about ischemic heart disease, we know hypertension causing heart failure. So what are the other comorbidities which can add to the risk of developing heart failure apart from this?
So our data suggests that diabetes is number one. It accounts for 61% and hypertension 54%. CKD is one third, 29%. So we are very clear that we are dealing with these three important things, diabetes, hypertension and CKD. Of course, ischemic heart disease accounts as the underlying disease present in 70% of our patients.
Okay. So we frequently now see a term called heart failure with normal ejection fraction. So what is it actually?
So I explained that if the left ventricle ejection fraction is 50% or more and patient has symptoms and signs of heart failure, is a clinical syndrome of effort intolerance, you would call this as heart failure with normal ejection fraction. In Western world, 50% cases are of heart failure, normal ejection fraction. In our country, that number is about 25% because of young population. Heart failure with normal ejection fraction is a disease of aging. And our society is younger.
Okay. So regarding diuretic resistance, how do you diagnose diuretic resistance in acute heart failure and what is that management you follow in the diuretic resistance?
So diuretic resistance is, there are multiple ways of looking the things. The simplest way is when you admit the patient, you give 1 milligram per kg of body weight of IV furosemide. And if you don't get a urine output which exceeds 150 ml per hour, it's diuretic resistance. Diuretic resistance can be because of multiple reasons, diabetes, CKD itself, use of steroids, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, infections, obesity, and insulin resistance. But the treatment is produce sequential nephron blockade, use drugs which work at PCT, DCT, loop of Henle, collecting tubule, and by combination of this, you can overcome diuretic resistance. So the drugs like tolvaptan has a role, drugs like esterazolamide has a role, metalazone has a role, drugs, even Pfizer diuretics have a role, and of course, aldosterone antagonist spironolactone has a role.
Okay. So we have some more questions, but we'll come back to you during the panel discussion for those questions. So is it okay? So we can go to the next presentation now. So the next presentation, I would like to welcome and invite Dr. Rishi Shukla, presentation on lipid management in diabetes, type 2 diabetes.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you're audible. Your slides are visible. You're on the first slide.
Good evening, friends. I was mesmerized by Dr. J.C. Mohan's lecture, so I was lost. It was a very nice lecture and covered everything. In fact, all day-to-day problems that we see in our life. And the most amazing fact is diabetes is a major contributory factor. And before I start, all these diseases are a lifestyle disease, and we can do a lot in terms of prevention. And before I start, thank you again for the opportunity. Thank you, Indranil, and thank you, Ipka, for this talk. And I was also seeing my good friend, Dr. Balram. I'm going to discuss diabetic dyslipidemia requires appropriate intervention. So I'll touch diabetes plus non-diabetic aspects also, because which are relevant in day-to-day practice.
Telecom, please enter, sir. Yeah.
You
can see the best. Yeah.
The best thing nowadays, we are all living. We are in post-COVID, but things are worst. Everybody, anybody. I mean, Amitabh Bachchan, did he not take care of himself, or are we not caring of ourselves? And we cannot avoid exposure. We have to work. We cannot sit in our home forever. So my humble request, take care as much as you can, and then leave on nature and God. Because beyond that, things are not even controlled in our control. So this is the status right now. Dr. Mohan was mentioning about the number of diabetes. The diabetes is increasing and will have 700 million diabetes by the 2045. One interesting thing I was observing that with passage of time in next 20 years or so, diabetes will increase, heart disease will increase, but the prevalence I was seeing, it will be from 9 to 10%. So what is happening that overall global population is going, and so the prevalence and incidence is going up. But the problem is, can we reduce it? Can we do something to that? And now coming to diabetes and cardiovascular disease, both of them are a leading cause of morbidity and mortality. And Indian data is, the diabetics have 4 times more chances of cardiovascular mortality. So this is what the status is. And if coming to dyslipidemia, as against the Western population, we have 90% Indian people, this is Indian data, 90% patients are having some sort of dyslipidemia, as against the 72% of Western population. Now the question is, we are undergoing the era of COVID. Would COVID-19 have any impact on future problems of diabetes and dyslipidemia? Because one thing, the COVID has direct effect at the level of pancreas. Second thing is, in lockdown and nowadays, because of taking over care, all of us have become little inactive, relatively inactive. We'll discuss later. Characteristics of dyslipidemia in patients with type 2 diabetes. Dyslipidemia is a major risk factor for cardiovascular diseases. And dyslipidemia present as a cluster of lipid, lipoprotein abnormalities, including elevation of fasting and postprandial. The most important thing that we classically see in Indians is raised triglyceride, raised small LDL-C particles, and low HDL. This is the classical. However, we do see mildly raised elevated LDL-C, LDL, that is what we need, and ApoA and ApoB. And increased waist circumference and elevation of triglyceride is a simple tool to capture high risk people with metabolic syndrome. And we see not in elderly population, but starting seeing from adolescent to youngsters to middle age to everyone. Diabetic dyslipidemia or diabetes lipidus. Another word that was used was diabetes lipi mellitus. Although diabetes and dyslipidemia are two separate risk factors for atherosclerosis, but they are so much interlinked that one enhances other. And I'll give a very small example. Whenever lipids are more, the triglycerides are more, the insulin resistance is more. And if insulin resistance is more, person is more prone to have uncontrolled diabetes, more prone to have newly detected diabetes, more prone to have hypertension, and more prone to have CAD. So this is, everything is interlinked. And the root cause is, again, I think, lifestyle. As a result, they should not be observed as separately for many reasons. And there is a vicious circle where dyslipidemia and diabetes, because if diabetes is more, all of you must have seen, whenever diabetes is more, the triglycerides level go up, and when triglycerides are more, the insulin resistance go up. What is Asian Indian phenotype? Because we are topping in all those things, as Dr. Mohan was saying, the heart failure also 65% is a reduce ejection fraction, which is amazing. And I was trying to guess, then possibly it is because we are only bothered when things become symptomatic. And the worst problem with diabetes, lipids, hypertension, and even in the beginning of coronary artery disease, they are asymptomatic. I always say, had sugar been symptomatic with 200, or I quote one example that more than 200 blood sugar, everybody gets abdominal pain, I think it will be controlled. Dyslipidemia, we don't know what is lipid until we measure. So So let us look at Indian phenotype. More abdominal fat. Our tummy is more compared to our western parts. Peptidine hypothesis, there are a couple of reasons. More insulin resistance and more hyperinsulinemia because we have more fat. So we have all this. High levels of C-reactive protein, high level of inflammation, low level of adiponectin. Higher is the adiponectin, more is the protection. Adiponectin is the hormone produced by adipocytes of the body. It has got a protective value. So lower is the value, less is the protection. And the characteristic dyslipidemia I have already mentioned. Increased susceptibility to type 2 diabetes and coronary artery disease. This is a standard 2 trial. I just wanted to put this trial for a reason. There was an intensive one and conventional one, and look at the mortality of type 2 diabetes. And what they did, they looked at the diastolic blood pressure, they looked at systolic blood pressure, triglycerides, cholesterol, not LDL, and glycosylated hormones. So if you have a multi-pronged approach, so what is most important is all these factors are responsible for overall outcome. Now coming to the lipids, the dyslipidemia starts from childhood and goes till we die. Younger people we see, it is dominantly familial type of dyslipidemia, and we usually need PCSK9 inhibitors, but as person enters into 20s, the atherogenesis progresses and the statins work. And the very effective trial that came, Jupiter trial, couple of years back, I think it was more than 18,000 patients, and the scheduled duration of trial was around 5 years, but it was abandoned just in, I think, 1.8 years because of a wonderful outcome. Statins proved so effective in reducing LDL-C, relative risk, heart failure, mortality. So it was a wonderful trial by all respect. Now the question is, are statins safe? There are more than 26 trials and similar rates of musculoskeletal symptoms with statin and comparator. Practically speaking, many of our patients complain of body aches and pains, and we sometimes don't come to it because there are many reasons. Dyslipidemia, vitamin D deficiencies, patients' stress, uncontrolled hypertension. There are so many other things. But the side effects as such are not seen so much. Very rarely rhabdomyolysis and severe myopathy. Slight excess risk of diabetes. I think it is not an issue. I'll discuss this separately because it is not very important. And it is seen only those already at the risk for diabetes who are at higher severity risk. Because those who are obese, I'll discuss this. We have a separate slide for this. And statin non-led patients tolerate blended statin. If you tell them that this is not a statin, many of them tolerate. I've seen a couple of patients with severe body ache, and when I stopped, but they were very specific, some doctors or bureaucrats, ministers, or some very intelligent patients. Before proceeding ahead, let us look at the modified risk factors. The diabetes, we can always control. And I always say, whenever a diabetic comes or a newly detected diabetic comes, say that it can be controlled to a non-diabetic range. Hypertension, again, is a very nicely controlled. Dyslipidemia, again, can be controlled. So these are three things that can be controlled by medicines and lifestyle both. Obesity, unless you are very obese, but again, this is a reversible factor. NASH is a new thing that has come in last couple of years, and it is very strongly associated with all this, and not only this, but again, also associated with cardiovascular disease. Excess alcohol intake, again, if somebody is careful, he can reduce or stop it. Then finally, stress with reason or without reason. Some people are stressed for nothing, and some people are stressed for tiny reason, but whatever is happening will happen. So I think we should counsel our patient, or what we should have a counselor to reduce their stress. And a word about drunkard. When a drunkard falls down, nobody will lift him. But when economy falls down, only drunkards have to lift. Because first thing post-lockdown, every government did was to open the liquor shops. My question is, why didn't they stop it? They should not have stopped at that point of time. And some people are jokingly saying those who are not drinking, they should stop paying the taxes. guidelines, I'll cover different guidelines and then I'll cover different things and to reach the conclusion. AD is the most common, which is pertaining to diabetes. Again, the lifestyle is very important, and what it says that if triglycerides are more than 150, possibly lifestyle is best thing. However, if triglycerides are more than 500, we need to be very active. Lifestyle, easier said than done. I mean, it is very easy lifestyle, but very tough. We and our patient both need to stick to it. We need to be motivated to motivate our patient. I mean, this is one line that is, I think we are not motivated enough. We are busy in seeing more patients. We are busy in managing many other things. We are busy in finishing fast. And nowadays, we are busy in distancing. But sticking to lifestyle gives confidence to our patients. And believe me, and all of us, you would be agreeing also that whenever lifestyle patients stick, they are more specific about their medicines also. And their medicines are reduced also. And this no medicine or minimum medicine with lifestyle gives absolute happiness. Because I think all of you, every day at least 20-30% of patients will be coming to you saying, doctor, please reduce my medicine. Doctor, please reduce my medicine. And it is to the tune to many of us that we are getting irritated. Because what we can do is two medicines only. Coming to the primary prevention, 40 to 70 years without atherosclerosis, or routine diabetic patients coming to our clinic, and they need moderate intensity statin. What is moderate and high intensity? I'll discuss in just a couple of minutes. So 40 to 75 years, statin moderate intensity. What to do with 20 to 39 years? So 20 to 39 years, with additional cardiovascular risk, if there is any risk factor, otherwise, if there is no risk factor, you can wait. And the patient 50 to 70 years with multiple cardiovascular risk factors, not having disease, it is reasonable to use high intensity. If a diabetic with a strong family history of coronary artery disease comes to you, use high intensity statin. So this is what it is. Secondary prevention. High intensity statin should be added to lifestyle if there is a diabetic patient with atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease. In high intensity statin, if it is not controlled and LDL remains more than 70, add ezetimibe or PCSK9 inhibitors. Ezetimibe would be a better choice because it is available, cheaper, and it is oral. It is contraindicated. All statins are contraindicated in pregnancy. So a middle-aged lady comes to you, please ask, are you planning pregnancy or not? Avoid about high intensity and moderate intensity statin. High intensity is atorvastatin 40 to 80 and rosuvastatin 5 to 10. Moderate intensity is atorvastatin 10 to 20 and rosuvastatin 5 to 20. So this is what. Now the question is, should we modify recommendations in type 2 diabetes and to document or rule out NASH in every type 2 patients by lipid profile, ultrasound holoprogram, and if needed, if possible, the fibroid scan. And here, primary prevention here is a keyword because we are talking in terms of primary prevention also. European Heart Society guidelines. This is a very practical way to assess our patients. There are a lot of calculators and risks, but this is a very nice way. So I put it, very high risk, and the moderate risk. What is high risk? Patient with diabetes with established cardiovascular disease or other target organ damage. What is the target organ damage? If there is proteinuria, renal impairment, hypertension, dyslipidemia, smoking, obesity, or elderly. So if any target organ damage one, if there is CAD or renal failure or target organ damage or three or more risk factors, diabetes with more than three risk factors. Suppose there is diabetes with a history of smoking, obese, and aging, possibly is a high risk. Then very high risk. Then high risk, patient with diabetes, duration more than 10 years without target organ damage, plus any other risk factor. More than 10 years plus one risk factor. And moderate, less than 10 years without risk factor. So this is a very practical way of doing. And what are the recommendations for management of dyslipidemia with lipid-lowering drugs? So the targets are 100, 70, 55, 85. I'll discuss what should be where. The treatment goals for LDL across category of total cardiovascular disease. So, as I discussed, for a very high category, target should be less than 55. High category, diabetes more than 20 years with risk factor, it should be 70. For moderate, less than 10 years, no risk factors or minimal risk factor, it should be 100. Recommendations for treatment of dyslipidemia and diabetes. So, what is said in patients with type 2 diabetes, very high risk, LDL reduction of at least 50% from baseline of LDL goal is recommended. These are ESC and ES guidelines. And intensification, what is important here is intensification of statin therapy should be considered for induction of combination therapy. So, as against the diabetes management, where we say multiple, we approach very aggressively to begin with, instead of metformin, we use 1-3 medicines in beginning. But here, keep increasing it, the statin to the maximum doses, and then, if not for, then azithromycin or PCSK9 inhibitors. And it is contraindicated. Statin therapy may be considered in both type 1 and type 2 patients aged less than 30 years with evidence of any end organ damage or a clear cut albuminuria, one should treat. And pregnancy is a contraindication. In perimenopausal and premenopausal, because we are seeing a lot of diabetes in 20s and many more in 30s, so one must ask the reproductive history. Rosuvastatin versus atorvastatin. And rosuvastatin was found to be more effective in reducing LDL, because if you look at here, this is type 2 diabetes and a 16 weeks trial. So rosuvastatin was more effective in reducing LDL-C compared to atorvastatin. However, they did not find any significant difference in HDL and triglycerides. Percentage of patients reaching a target is 81% versus 65% in rosuvastatin. What is the effect of, we are writing medicine, and what is the expected effect of all these statins? If we are giving moderate intensity statin, around 30% reduction is expected. Sometimes it goes below, we have seen. High intensity, 50%. If you add STMI with high intensity, 65%. And only PCSK9 inhibitor, 60%. This is a very effective tool, but it is injectable and expensive. PCSK9 plus high intensity, if you add two together, is statin plus 75%. If you add all three, then it is 85%. So this is, but by and large, 30 to 50% that we see in our routine practice. ACC, AHA guidelines on primary prevention of cardiovascular disease. This is a very busy slide, but I would like you to focus at what to do at 0 to 9 years, what to do 20 to 39 years, what to do 40 to 75 years. This is basically a familial dyslipidemia. I'll discuss this separately. 20 to 39 years, what is most important is a cutoff of 160 LDL. If LDL is more than 160, then we should treat. And what to do with 40 to 70, and this comprises all patients with dyslipidemia, irrespective of diabetes. And here, if LDL is more than 190, no risk assessment, straight away go and treat. Diabetes mellitus at 45, if there is a diabetes and the range is not even 190, then you should write. I'll discuss everything separately. No, this is one by one. Suppose we see a patient's non-diabetic 20 to 39 years and when to start a statin. Major LDL, and if LDL is more than 160 plus family history of atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, immediately you start a statin. This is normal, healthy, non-diabetic individual. LDL more than 160, no family history, give him an or her a chance of lifestyle and follow-up. We start going down, please wait. And if LDL is more than 160, in spite of lifestyle, possibly it's time to start low-intensity statin. Then 40 to 75 years, non-diabetic. 70 to 190, please go for risk assessment. If there is a very high risk, or a high risk, I think statin is required. If low risk, lifestyle changes. Moderate to high risk, start statin. If LDL is more than 190, as I told you earlier, no risk assessment is needed to start a statin. 20-20, yes, we see younger children also. Majority of them are familial dyslipidemia. No statin is recommended before 10 years. Many resting myBORG PCSK9 inhibitors, as many of them are refractory to statin, may give a trial of statin moderate if you feel if the child is more than 10 years. Type 1, again, is a very controversial area. All people with type 1 diabetes, age more than 40 years, moderate intensity statin. Diabetes more than 10 years, type 1, moderate intensity. All T1, D1 less than 40 years with documented nephropathy. If there is nephropathy or even there is retinopathy, please start the statin. Less than 40 years with CVD risk, family history of atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease positive, please start. More than 20 years of duration, less or more, whatever is the age, high intensity statin. Now coming to a question, statins and diabetes risk. Do statins increase the diabetes risk? The CVD benefits are more than risk. In different trials, a subset of risk population is more prone. Because those who are obese, who are family history, so these are, in any case, they are going to develop. So they are more prone. However, the possible mechanisms are affecting calcium channel blockers of beta cells, glucose transporters, and decrease in cutane enzyme, which has a role in glucose metabolism, and there is reduced adiponectin level. I told you in the beginning, adiponectin lower is bad thing. It is actually very, very controversial topic. Should we start giving statins to non-diabetic, yes or no? To my understanding, we should, yes, because it has a huge protective value compared to the risk. Risk is very small, the protection is much more. Aspirin and diabetes, it is not recommended as primary prevention, may be considered as primary prevention in high-risk patients. Again, there is a very strong family history of atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, to be used as secondary prevention in those with atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, and clopidogrel to be used as secondary prevention in case aspirin allergy is documented. So, lockdown and S, we have seen 360 degree, we have seen beautiful things. Life was beautiful, all of us have started giving time to ourselves. So much has happened, so much we have seen. First time I walked in the terrace of my home. But there is limit to appreciate beautiful things. Now we want to be out, we want to be liberated, we want to be off mask. I want to talk to my friends, I want to meet my friends, and I want to hug my friends. How precious is hugging? How precious is meeting our friends and our relatives? I mean, this is what we are realizing. I think this is time to realize, and this is time to realize, value the relationships, value your connects, because we are only virtually connected nowadays. However, we need to understand, sunshine is same for all of us, rich, poor, good, bad, ladies, gents, and for anyone. All lives are same. So 40% in population is dependent on daily earnings. So a lot of people are in serious trouble. Many businesses are going down. Look at tourist industry. Look at hoteling industry. Those small hotelers who have taken loans, and so things are really in bad service. So we need to give. Other side of 360 degree, I'm not putting any pictures, because the picture is worse, so you can imagine. But we all think in terms of thinking positive about them, and whatever way we can touch, we should. Coming to the conclusion, there is a high prevalence of dyslipidemia in patients with diabetes, 90%. Statins are recommended as a first choice lipid lowering treatment in patients with DM with LDL-C. So any type 2 diabetic above 40, statin, please. Moderate intensity statins to be prescribed to all diabetic patients over 40 years, in addition to lifestyle for primary prevention. STMIB in combination with statins can result in incremental lowering of LDC levels and further improve cardiovascular. This is, I think, what we are not using. And finally, PCSK9 inhibitor could be integrated into the management of individuals with diabetes and dyslipidemia. I have not used them, but if I could have used it, many of my colleagues have used. They can be used in addition to statins, STMIB, and fibrates. In appropriately selected individuals with diabetes, these new agents can assist further to improve lipid lowering profile and reduce cardiovascular events, but their current use is limited by their cost. we need to join hands together to help people all across the country. This is one of the meeting on SSDI in Lucknow, where we had a meeting with type 1 diabetes. Type 1 is my passion. So all children are keeping candles and lot many people are there. So with this, thanks a lot for your kind attention. I think I'll be happy and I enjoyed my deliberation. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Shukla, for your wonderful presentation and also wonderful insights about different aspects of life in your presentation. So we have some questions for you, so few questions, and then we'll come back again to you during the panel. So first question is that diabetes have a very notorious distinction of, statins have a very notorious distinction of causing diabetes. And in India, we are seeing a lot of patients who are young patients who are having dyslipidemia. So what is your take on that? If somebody is below 40, suppose 30, 35, and if there is a high risk, should we prescribe statins or not?
Yeah, I think I told you. We have to look at, I think any diabetic LDL above 100, I mean this is gold standard.
If they are non-diabetic, we are talking about non-diabetic.
Non-diabetic, what we do, below 40 we measure LDL. If it is more than 160 and positive, in that case if there is a positive family history of atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, family history of heart attack or myocardial infarction, they should be prevented. More than 160 with no risk. They should be given a chance to go down, then work with lifestyle. If it doesn't, then we have to protect them. So this is the way it is. And okay. if it is less than 160, we should not do anything. But again, in less than 160, if there is a very high risk, then one has to think. Yes.
So do you use the ACVD risk calculator or any other risk calculator for measuring whether the patient have a lifetime risk?
I shared a very nice risk calculator for diabetes. I mean, this is what very high and the moderate. This I think is very, because every time in real life it is not possible. I calculated Framingham risk to begin with, but there are a couple of, they make our life cumbersome. And by understanding, we know the risk. Patient is a smoker, patient is positive, family history of diabetes, patient is for, I mean, you just keep in our mind and then move on. But high risk, very high risk, moderate risk, very high risk and moderate risk, these things are simple clinical terms that are helpful to us.
So in type 2 diabetic patients, you said that we saw in a presentation you talk about moderate intensity statin prescribing. So is there any case in diabetic patients, type 2 diabetes patients, you prescribe high intensity in the highest dose? Are there any type of patients like that?
See, my experience is that most of the patients respond to moderate intensity. So this is one. How are the recommendations for if diabetes is more than 20? Because the functions at the level of the atherosclerotic wall, we want that level of anti-inflammatory effect. So that is the key. A subset of patients, especially in familial dyslipidemia, I have seen the responses, I mean, to the, sometimes they did not respond to maximum doses of statin plus SGLT2. And PCSK9 inhibitors are not readily available. Not available, I think, in India. Offline, I think, off-label they are available. Dr. J.C. Mohan can comment better on that, or Dr. Balram Sharma, but I have never used them. But this is a good choice, those who are refractory. But most of patients, they respond to moderate or high intensity statins. This is good thing to
do. Okay.
Yes.
Sir, if there is a scenario, like in type 2 diabetes patients, we have LDL norm 95. Would you prescribe a statin in that case also?
Question is not
Yeah. Yes. So if you're a type 2 diabetes patient, the LDL level is 95. LDL level is 95. So would you prescribe a statin in that case?
Type 2 diabetes, above, if the patient is above 40, it should be prescribed. If it is less than 40, then so all diabetes, because it has an anti-inflammatory role, because it is irrespective of that. And less than 40 years, then you have to look at the risk.
Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Shukla.
Very nice question.
Thank you. Okay, so we'll come back to you with the panel discussion. We have some more questions for you. We'll come back during the panel. So we'll now go to Dr. Sharma for his presentation, hypoglycemia in type 2 diabetes.
Hello, Indra. Am I visible and audible?
Yes, I can see your presentation.
Yeah, thank you. So after these two excellent presentations, I'm going to discuss a little clinically relevant topic. This is quite relevant in day-to-day practice, and this is very important also because we know that a lot of medicines are available nowadays to treat diabetes in the armamentarium to fight diabetes. But because of various reasons, we are lacking beyond the ideal target. Still, we are not able to achieve the appropriate targets or the HbA1c targets at the tune of the best control, which is less than 7 around the nearly one third of the patients. So, why that is so? So, the very important reason, despite availability of a lot of medicines, is the hypoglycemia. And that's why this is very important clinically relevant topic in one has to be quite clear in the clinical practice about these aspects. So this is the old slide, and everybody is aware about it, that how the global prevalence of diabetes is increasing like anything, including India, not only India but the world also. And according to this IDF figures, in coming few years, like that 2045, the numbers are going to rise nearly by 80% or so. So as I was discussing that, what are the barriers to achieve glycemic targets? So barriers or the inertia might be at different level, might be at the clinician's level, might be at the patient's level. At the clinician level, the inertia might be because of the fear about this hypoglycemia. That is very, very important. The other issues might also be there, like the tolerance or the efficacy of the medication or the appropriateness of the use or the at the patient table also, there might be some inertia in terms of affordability, inertia in terms of the tolerability of compliance of various medications, or the cost might be an issue. But the very important part again is the hypoglycemia. If somebody is developing hypoglycemia, then that is the time which is actually horrible. The patient is actually frightened. The whole family is frightened about this particular entity. And I have seen multiple times that whenever the patient is developing hypoglycemia, they are not much keen now to control the diabetes aggressively because they know that this might be risky. So this is among the very important barriers in diabetes management, and particularly to achieve the appropriate glycemic targets. So we have a lot of medications, but still we have challenges, and the main challenge is the hypoglycemia. And we know that if we are trying little strict control, then the chances of hypoglycemia will be definitely more. And that has been shown by the landmark trials also. Here you can see that in the landmark Accord Advanced or VADD trial, here you can see that in the standard control arm, where the intensive control was not tried or achieved, the chances of hypoglycemia is significantly less in comparison to intensive group. Here you can see that in the Accord, in the standard arm, on hypoglycemia incidences was only 5% or so, but in the intensive group this was nearly 16%, and that was one of the reasons for the increase in mortality also. In the advanced, where the sustained release glycoside was used, here again, although the medicine was sustained release and one of the safest sulfonylurea what we can claim, but still the chances of hypoglycemia was there, but that was not up to that. In VADD, again, we can see here that in the standard arm, only 9% or 10% of hypoglycemia is well in control, 20% or even more the hypoglycemia incidences were there. So whenever we are trying strict glycemic control, that definitely increases the hypoglycemia risk. How often this is? Look at the various figures. This particular study was published in 2011, and here they looked at the event frequencies, and here you can see that in type 1 patients who are on various insulin regimens, and we know that in type 1 diabetes, the chances of hypoglycemia are significantly more common than the type 2 diabetes, although that is there. And in most of the patients, the chances of hypoglycemia are there. Here you can see that in type 1 patient, nearly 80% of the patient are having either daily or once a week or at least several times per month hypoglycemia. Similarly, in type 2 diabetes also, nearly 60% of patients are having hypoglycemic events at least several times per month. And hypoglycemia might be at any time, that might be at work, that might be at exercise, that might be when you are resting, but that might be at sleep also. And during the sleep, the hypoglycemia is really dangerous. And I'm sure that all of you have the experience of seeing lot of a risky situation where the hypoglycemia was there in the functional time. If you look at the classification, hypoglycemia might be of various categories, but if the hypoglycemia is below 70, but that is above 55, then this is in the mild hypoglycemia category. Mild means the patient is feeling the classical symptomatology of hypoglycemia we'll be discussing in coming few slides. But the patient is able to manage the hypoglycemia by himself or herself. Means for this, the patient do not need any assistance of anybody. But if the hypoglycemia is below 55, this is called moderate hypoglycemia, and this is a really risky situation. But this becomes severely risky once the hypoglycemia is below 45 or below 40 even. And that can lead into the coma or the unconsciousness. So these are the simple classifications. ADA has also tried to classify the hypoglycemia. Similarly, like a level 1 classification of hypoglycemia, which is mild type. This is below 70 but more than 54. Level 2, less than 54. While in level 3, this is the severe E, that is, I just mentioned, that is characterized by the alteration in the mental status or physical status. And at this particular moment, means in this severe event, the patient is not able to manage this particular episode by himself. Means for this, he needs assistance of somebody. And most of the time, he needs assistance of doctor or a hospital. Otherwise, he is going to land into the trouble. So what are those factors which make risky for hypoglycemia? We know that obviously the medications are one, particularly the insulins or the citratrophs. But if the patient has impaired kidney function or impaired hepatic reserve, then again there might be a problem. If somebody is diabetic for longer duration, again the chances are more. If somebody is older or frailty and he is living alone and his cognitive functions are not that good, then again there will be a problem. But the most important point and the problem is if the patient do not have that counter-regulatory response or the classical symptomatology of hypoglycemia we will be discussing, this is called hypoglycemia unawareness. So if hypoglycemia unawareness is there, then these things are really, really very, very bad. Means the patient is developing hypoglycemia, but he is not developing that classical symptomatology of tremors, weakness, fatigability, sweating, or tachycardia, or dryness in the mouth, or weakness. So this classical symptomatology is not there. This patient is having a risky category of hypoglycemia, but still he is feeling that he is all right, he is normal, and he is not monitoring the glucose regularly. And directly, these kind of patients are actually landing into the coma or in the severe stage. The other risk factor might be the physical or intellectual disability, which impair their behavioral response, and some alcohol like might also be of the high risk. But while there are few medications that may also potentiate the hypoglycemia, because they inhibit the sympathetic response of hypoglycemia. These are the classic symptomatology, as we were just discussing, that we can classify into two simple classification. One is neurogenic and other one is neuroglycopenic. Neurogenic is simply the autonomic nervous system function or the response of body, while the neuroglycopenic symptoms are actually caused by the deprivation of brain glucose supply. So these first category is simple, like shaking, tremors, anxiety, nervousness, palpitation, cold and clammy skin, sweating, dry mouth, hunger, pallor. These all are the simple and everybody is aware. While the second, when the patient is in the severe category of hypoglycemia, there are like alteration in the mental status. The patient is confused. The patient has difficulty in decision making. The patient has difficulty in speaking or seeking the help. He is not able to call his colleagues, or he's not able to call his family members because of these all problems, and ultimately that may lead into seizures, trauma, or even death if that's not treated. So how risky the hypoglycemia might be, means the patient was all right, but because of this simple problem or the common problem, I won't say this is simple, but this is a common problem that may lend the patient to trauma. What is the probable impact of hypoglycemia on different organs and on other dysregulatory responses? So just have a look that the hypoglycemia might have impact on brain, as we were just discussing, that may lead to seizures, that may lead to the cognitive problems, or that may ultimately lead to the coma. That may have impact on eye, might lead to diplopia, decrease in retinal sensitivity, decrease retinal viability, or loss of vision might be there if that is prolonged. Hypoglycemia may lead to the various inflammatory responses that may lead to the endotheliopathy or endothelial dysfunction, or blood coagulation abnormalities might be there. The very important part is the impact on sympathoadrenal response. Changes might be there in the susceptible genes. Okay. That may lead to the hemodynamic because of the response. If the patient is already a developed group, their problems might be very possible to illness problems or the significant impact of severe hypoglycemia that can ultimately lead to the increased event and mortality, as we've just seen. And here, again, you can see that in the initial of severe hypoglycemia, the chances of various microvascular event, vascular event, or death from any cause of cardiovascular or non-cardiovascular deaths are more common than you can see. But when the time goes, and then the chances becomes little less. But the maximum chances are the period after the hypoglycemia or the severe episode of hypoglycemia means they may lead into the various cardiovascular problems, various arrhythmias, various respiratory changes, or the patient might lead to trauma or seizures or so on and so forth. High incidence of nocturnal hypoglycemia is actually very, very dangerous in comparison to the daytime hypoglycemia because everybody is vigilant. The patient is either at work or either at home, but there is somebody who can take care or help him or her. Or seeking help is quite easy in the daytime in comparison to the nocturnal time. So if nocturnal hypoglycemia is there, the chances of poor outcome are significantly more. And we know that sleep weakens the neuroendocrine defense mechanism against hypoglycemia, and that can ultimately better. So the same was shown by this study also. So what is the pathophysiology of hypoglycemia in type 2 diabetes mellitus? We know about the classical insulin secretion and the regulatory counter-regulatory mechanism working on to maintain the normal. So we know that at beta cell level, the problem is that when we are using any insulin, so exogenous insulin is there, or either we are using secretagogues, then being secreted by the secretagogue. So the defect might be at this level. Defect might be at the hepatic level because there might be the poor glycogenolysis or gluconeogenesis might be impaired. And this is actually because of the impaired counter-regulatory hormone response. We'll be seeing this in the next one slides. The defect might be at the level of skeletal muscles, or if the patient is doing exercise, then the uptake of glucose by the skeletal muscle might be low. At alpha cell defect, the glucagon response, which is the first counter-regulatory defense mechanism, suppressed due to impaired counter-regulatory system. And if hypoglycemia is there, then the brain response already we have discussed. But what is the normal defense? Normal defenses, like in a normal person, whenever there is hypoglycemia, the insulin secretion is decreased, everyone is aware about this part, glucagon secretion is increased. And at the same time, there is increase in the counter-regulatory hormone chain. So first of all, there is increase in the epinephrine, norepinephrine, then the cortisol is increased, then the growth hormone is again increased. So these all are actually the counter-regulatory hormones to insulin action. So whenever these counter regulatory hormones are in play, the chances of hyperglycemia are less. So in normal person, where these all regulatory mechanisms are working properly, and then the chances of hyperglycemia are not there, even when somebody is fasting. But the same is not true for the diabetic, particularly those who are on medication, particularly secret over insulin, and those who are diabetic for the long duration. Here again, you can see the normal counter-regulatory glucose defense mechanism, that whenever there is hypoglycemia, the glucose level is decreased in the blood, and that is that leads to decreased insulin secretion from the beta cell and increased alpha cell activation, and that leads to increased glucagon, and this glucagon actually leads to the increased glycosinolysis or increased gluconeogenesis, and both ultimately lead to increased peripheral glucose level. Similarly, if you look at the adrenal medulla, then at adrenal medulla, there is increased secretion of epinephrine, although this is not shown in this particular picture, but the other counter-regulatory hormones like the cortisol, like the norepinephrine, like the growth hormone, these all are in action at the time of hypoglycemia, although the earliest are this glucagon and then later on the other also in injection. They ultimately lead to the normalization of glucose level. Similarly, these all sympathoadrenal outflow actually increase the classical symptomatology as we have just discussed, and that ultimately lead to the neurogenic symptoms, and patient is in the condition, or he is feeling hungry or appetite, or he seeks something to eat, and then there is increased of carbohydrate, and that ultimately lead to level of normalization of the level. The same help, now this the muscle, kidney, and fat also act to increase the glucose level by the action of epinephrine. So this is the normal physiological mechanism. But this is not here actually working in the diabetic blood, non-diabetic. If you look at, in this table here, you can see that in non-diabetic, the response, like when the glucose is low, insulin is again decreased, glucagon is increased, epinephrine. Well, in type 1 diabetes, as insulin is not available, means the endogenous insulin is not available, so there is no decrease. So whatever exogenous insulin is there, that is going to remain in the circulation. Well, the response of glucagon increase is also defective, and epinephrine releases again. The similar is there in type 2 diabetic, particularly in those where the diabetic they are of longer duration. Well, in the early diabetic, the response is almost normal. It's not like a normal fellow. The early diabetics, type 2 diabetics are given, but in the longer diabetic duration, the insulin decrement or the increase in glucagon or the epinephrine level are actually attenuated. Ultimately, they are leading to a defense. One very important factor is hypoglycemia associated autonomic failure, which is known as HAAF, H-A-A-F. So, what is HAAF? So, HAAF is the condition where there is impairment in these all counter mechanisms. So, the insulin is not decreased, there is glucagon. Particularly, the symptomatology, which we were discussing just now, is not perceived by the patient. That ultimately lead to the non-awareness or unawareness of hypoglycemia, and the patient is doing his activities or he is sleeping like normal, but the glucose level is declining, and ultimately that will lead to neuroglycopenia, glucopenia, and ultimately it will lead to sort of coma or arrhythmia. Here you can see that the hypoglycemia associated autonomic failure. So in the long diabetic patient, autonomic failure is there, and that ultimately lead to these all complications that have just discovered because of these, during the exercise or during the sleep or during the working or during the normal activity, the patient has attenuated sympathetic response to hypoglycemia. So these all cardiovascular, counter-regulatory actions are not perceived by the patient, and that will be effective defense in both ways, like at the patient level or at the physiology level. And the patient is developing recurrent hypoglycemia. These kind of patient where autonomic failure is there, the chances of poor outcome are significantly through we can manage hypoglycemia. So best, as we are running the COVID time and again we are making prevention. So the similar is true for hypoglycemia also, that the prevention is always better. So we can keep on monitoring blood glucose level, and we can individualize the target of patient. So individualization of target actually leads to the poor chances of hypoglycemia. How we can do that, we will be on slides. Or we can choose those medications which has low incidences of hypoglycemia. I'm sure that everybody is aware of that. And if the patient has developed hypoglycemia, then we have to treat it urgently to manage or to avoid the outcome. So how we can prevent? So prevention is very important in those who are asymptomatic hypoglycemia patient, or we have half his ear or hypoglycemia. So regular monitoring or SMB is very important part. CGMS is a very important modality if that can be done or the patient is affordable. We are doing in various patients who are actually affordable. And CGMS is really useful, but particularly useful in those where nocturnal hypoglycemia episodes are there, or those where autonomic hypoglycemia are there. Or the CGMS might be in the form of real-time or intermittent fasting. But they ultimately can help to reduce the chances of hypoglycemia. We can titrate the doses of insulin or medications, or we can change the feeding habits of the patient according to the pattern of the CGMS also. But the very important entity that how we can avoid most of the episodes of hypoglycemia is the individualization of targeting. Means the very strict target are not necessary for everybody, and they are not tolerable by everybody. So for those patients, most of the type 1 or type 2 patient, less than 7 is okay. You can try less than 7, even up to 6.5 or so. In those patients where there is no complication, they are early diabetic, they are living with family, they have very good sense, their IQ is okay, their education level is okay. Otherwise, for the remaining patient, like those who are elderly patient, who has limited life expectancy, who has recurrent hypoglycemic episodes, then the target might be a little relaxed in the form of that might be ranging from 7.5 to 8, or even 5 might be okay for those patients where these limitations are there. Various novel medication can also decrease the chances of hypoglycemia. In this list, you can see that which sulfonylurea or secretagogues or insulin are definitely having high risk of hypoglycemia. While we have lot of safe options, DPP-4 is one of them, as thiazolidinediones and glucoside inhibitor. I'm not going into the detail of these all because everybody is aware. Everybody is aware about these all, but these are those steps by which we can do hypoglycemia. The ADA guidelines also suggest the same. Then when there is a compelling need to minimize the hypoglycemia, we have a lot of options. Options in the form of DPP-4 or SGLT2 inhibitors. If somebody is affordable and tolerable, then GLP-1 can be tried. And the time-tested thiazolidinediones are out there. Although we were discussing heart failure in the initial presentation, so for those patients, we have to see that in which patient we can use which medicine. So depending upon various factors, the clinician is the best just to decide that which medicine is okay. But these are the list of those medications which have low hypoglycemia. Similarly, we have various insulin analogs also. Insulin analogs, which has significantly less risk of hypoglycemia. We now have the prolonged acting or long acting insulin analogs, basal insulin analog. And recently, 2020, there was a television by Novo that even the weekly basal insulins, they are fine. That might be available soon. So that will again decrease the chances of hypoglycemia. But for short acting or ultra short acting insulin, we have the FIAS type of insulin, which is ultra short, and the chances of hypoglycemia are again less with this type of insulin. The use of SMBG, self monitoring of blood glucose, or the CGMS devices definitely help to decrease the episodes of hypoglycemia. These are a few pictorials by which we can see that, in comparison to the older basal insulin, which was actually NPH, the chances of 5% was significantly more. And we know Dr. Shukla would be agree with me that during the days of NPH insulin therapy, we were mostly struggling with the diabetes control and patient, but I had them into the high dose and high dose. But with the invention of these newer analogs like Tetimid, like Largine, like Degludec, or even as I just mentioned, chances of hypoglycemia. But if somebody has developed hypoglycemia, we have to pay particular attention about this particular part. Because of the COPDs, we are mostly not able to explain each and everything, but we have to explain this particular entity to every patient when we are going to treat any diabetic patient, because this is really life-saving, and that will keep the confidence of patient in the treatment also. So if somebody is developing hypoglycemia, then how we can manage it? We need not to rush to a hospital for every hypoglycemia event. We need not to call to your doctor, but he himself can manage. So these all things we have to explain. This is called the classical rule of 15, that 15 gram of glucose or sugar or honey or other things we can use, we have to wait for 15 minutes. If the blood glucose level is more than 70 or 80 and you are feeling all right, that's okay, then take something else. Otherwise, you can repeat the same amount within next 15 minutes. So this rule of 15 has to be explained to every patient, because this is life-saving and that will keep the confidence of the patient. Otherwise, these episodes actually lead to a frightened experience, or the patient's confidence is significantly less and he does not have much confidence on the treatment, and the ultimate outcome will be poor outcome and various complications will occur. So if somebody is conscious, then he himself can manage it. But if somebody is unconscious, then you have to again explain, then don't try to put anything into the mouth of an patient, because that will lead to the aspiration in the various other complication and life-threatening. But those patients, simple dextrose is perfect to treat. 15-25% is available, if 50% is available, that is okay, but 25% is available most of the time. Even 10% might work for those patients. But those patients who are on insulin therapy, the best is to use glucagon also at least once. But if we don't have glucagon, then one should not wait. We have to simply use the dextrose as soon as the patient is in the regarding the use of glucagon, ADA has again recommended that those patients who are at increased risk of hypoglycemia and their glucose level is less than 54, the glucagon can be used. And this can be simply used subcutaneously, this can be IM also, although this isn't costly. Medicine nearly 7-8 rupees is the cost per injection of glucagon. And there are other medications, but the best is to modify the glycemic goals or the fire target. Means we have to individualize the target of the patient. In those patients who are at increased risk, like those who are elderly, those who are prolonged diabetic for years together, those who are having various complications in the form of the diabetic kidney disease, CKD, or the patient is having neuropathy, particularly the autoimmune neuropathy, then we have to keep the relaxed target. At the same time, we have to choose those medications which the patient can keep on taking regularly without much risk of hypoglycemia. There are various other medications like alanine, methylxanthine, or fructose. They have also used, but the data is not much available. But very important part is diabetes education, as I just mentioned. So, with the increased number of diabetic patients, significantly we are now bombarded with patients of diabetes. And whenever you are trying to achieve the diabetes control, hypoglycemia is definitely the biggest barrier. So, in appropriate patient, we can be little aggressive. But those patients who are not suitable or who are at increased risk of hypoglycemia, one has to be very particular. You have to reset the targets. You have to choose the appropriate medicine, but we should never forget the importance of diabetes education, particularly that how the patient and the relative can take care of during the time of hypoglycemia, because that is really life-saving. Thank you. Thanks a lot for your patience here.
Thank you, Dr. Sharma, for your wonderful presentation. So we'll have a few questions for you. The first question is that first question for you is Dr. Sharma. We talked about hypoglycemia, and we know you talked about the relationship with myocardial infarction and other ischemic heart disease. But what about the relationship of hypoglycemia to other microvascular and macrovascular complications of diabetes?
Yeah, in one slide I showed that the chances of hypoglycemia might actually increase the various events, including the cardiac event, particularly atherosclerotic event. And in long term, if recurrent hypos are there, then that will lead to the vasculopathy. And I showed that. So if that is there, then that can lead to the complication in form of this microvascular event. But that is there. With recurrent recurrent episodes of hypoglycemia. And in one slide I showed that the chances of macrovascular event, the chances of microvascular event or the death from any cause, cardiovascular causes or non-cardiac cardiovascular causes increases, but they are more in the initial time of in the initial coming a few weeks or a few years after the recurrent episodes of hypoglycemia. So yes, the chances of micro and macrovascular complication might also be increased because of
Now we're coming to sulfonylurea, are also known to cause a lot of hypoglycemic episodes. Now, if you choose a sulfonylurea, which one will you choose? Glycoside and lumepiride. Which is the one which will you choose?
Actually, in setup like India. Everybody is aware that we have to use sulfonylurea, and I'm sure that anybody who is practicing medicine is actually using sulfonylurea. Nobody can deny that he is not using sulfonylurea. But the simple thing is to choose the best one. So with the available data, I can say that with the older sulfonylurea, only one is available, that is glimepiride. The chances of hypoglycemia were significantly more, and whenever there is hypoglycemia, the hypoglycemia is recurring again and again. That is happening. I can remember a case during my DM training that there was a pujari of an temple priest, and he had fast on that particular day. So he was not able to take anything during the daytime, but in the early morning, he just wake up at 4 o'clock and he just took that glimepiride because he was not going to take anything in the daytime. And in the evening hour, because he was keep on fasting during the whole day, he landed into the hypoglycemia unconscious. And in the next early morning, like at 3-4 o'clock in the early morning next day, they came that patient to the emergency department at my institute, and I attended that patient. But we were not able to improve that particular patient, and he landed into the coma and vegetables because of these dangerous situations. So one has to be very particular that only single mistake might lead you into the coma or life-threatening conditions. So the safe sulfonylurea are the newer ones. Either the glimepiride or either the glycoside, these are better. But advanced trial has shown us that if you are using glycoside, particularly the sustained release preparation, then the chances of hypoglycemia are significantly less. And in my presentation also, I showed that in comparison to the VADT or ECHO in advance, the chances of hypoglycemia were not that much because of the prolonged or the sustained release preparation. So the best is the newer sulfonylurea, including glimepiride and glycoside, but even better is glycoside sustained release preparation in terms of hypoglycemia risk.
Okay. Now, have you seen any patient who has more or less normal HbA1c, like 7.5, almost near target or on target as far you have set the target for the patient, and still the patient is having some episodes of hypoglycemia?
Yeah, this is quite common in day-to-day practice that the patient are landing into the hypoglycemia. But most of the time, the hypoglycemias are because of the poor communication with the patient. means either the patient are landing into hypoglycemia because they have taken the tablet, but now they have they are in the market or for some task and they have not taken their meal and they are landing into the hypoglycemia, or the particularly reduction in hypoglycemia, because if somebody is going to sleep at the level of blood glucose level 90, he will be all right, but time the response is sluggish, as we can see it easily. But if somebody is monitoring, then he is able to respond even before the hypoglycemia is known, or the continuous glucose monitoring. Yes, we are doing a lot of CGMS in various patients who are affordable, particularly because this is a little costly affair. The Medtronic device is costing nearly 3,000 or so, while the Abbott device is costing nearly 1,700 or so. Costly affair, but in those who can afford, particularly in type 1 patient, we are using it. And that can tell you that which are the maximum time or the commonest time of day when this particular patient is developing hypoglycemia. So then you can explore that your intake is not that good at a particular time, or are you going for exercise or walk on telemesis at that particular time. So you can up titrate or not, or give me that, and you can decrease the chances of it.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Mohan. Promotion for you. So we are in the panel discussion now. So we'll come back to you. So Dr. Mohan, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Yes. Dr. Mohan, you're regarding your presentation on heart failure. So you said during your presentation that in preserved ejection fraction, there is limited role of beta blockers. So if you have a patient with preserved ejection fraction, is there any role at all, or is there any patient you use?
No, beta blockers actually have extremely limited role in heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. However, they do have a role in heart failure with the mid-range ejection fraction. The data suggests that these people reduce hospitalization for heart failure and improve mortality in people whose ejection fraction between 40 to 49%. Of course, they are working below 40% as well. But above 50%, actually, we don't have solid data. The seniors' data actually is of people who are between 35 and 50%. So we need to keep one thing in mind, that beta blockers you might use actually for control of atrial fibrillation in treatment of post MI situation with normal ejection fraction, and who may have actually where beta blocker is given not as an anti-failure therapy but to prevent arrhythmias or myocardial infarction. So compelling indication, you can give beta blocker, but beta blocker per se have no role in heart failure with preserved ejection fraction.
Okay. If you come to now reduced ejection fraction, HFrEF, so in these patients, if you have a choice of metoprolol, bisoprolol, carvedilol, what is your personal choice of using beta blocker?
So I use all three of them equally. How do I decide? What do I choose from? One of the important thing is that fortunately metoprolol is available in combination with ramipril. And quite often when it is a pill burden is an issue, I would use a combination of metoprolol plus ramipril. Bisoprolol is not available to best of my knowledge with any of the ACE inhibitors, so I am unable to use it. Similarly, carvedilol is not available in combination. The issue with carvedilol is you need many steps for up titration. And also hypotension remains an issue with carvedilol, because of the alpha blocking property. So people who have relatively borderline blood pressure, my choice is more like bisoprolol, which is highly selective, more selective than metoprolol. But metoprolol is used 50% cases simply because it is available in combination with ramipril, perindopril and other things like that. But having said that, usually one third, that is what it is. I wouldn't say that I try to differentiate them, but it has to be metoprolol succinate, and I don't use metoprolol tartrate.
Okay, so if must be targeting a particular heart rate in this patients like 70 or 75, so if you do not achieve this heart rate, what do you do?
So the you have actually choices are very clear. you should try to use beta blocker and uptitrate to the maximum dose, but because if the blood pressure does not allow, fatigue doesn't allow, erectile dysfunction doesn't allow, asthma does not allow, you have to use evobradin. Evobradin, you start with 5 mg twice a day, but only in sinus rhythm, not in atrial fibrillation. Take it to maximum of 7.5 mg twice a day, and that mostly will help you. So a combination of beta blocker plus evobradin will help you to get the heart rate below 70 in most of the people.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Mohan. Now going to Dr. Shukla. Dr. Shukla, can you hear me, sir?
Yes.
Okay. Now, regarding diabetic dyslipidemia. So we have a question that if you have a patient with diabetic dyslipidemia, yes, LDL-C is a most important marker for you. But would you also look equally into non-fasting or lipids like non-HDL-C, triglycerides, all those aspects when you determine the risk factor in these patients, residual risk in this patient?
Yeah. Actually, we do look at three things. One is the triglyceride, other is the non-HDL. Non-HDL risk, so that is total cholesterol minus HDL, and it should be less than 100. So this is another target because it comprises a couple of things. And HDL also is important, but we don't have any strong tool to increase it. Now, the treatment guidelines are very simple, that any triglyceride above 500 should be treated. Between 150 to 500, it should be a lifestyle. But there are a number of studies which are saying if it is more than 200, it should be brought back to normal, and it has shown positive reports. Number two, there is a very latest trial, trial, where icosapent was used. I think in 2019, NEJM, it was published. And this trial categorically showed by icosapent in a very strong triglyceride lowering agent, and it showed that there was a definite improvement in terms of cardiovascular risk, cardiovascular mortality, 3-point MACE. So this was one trial that is indicating somewhere that triglycerides are now probably quite important, but next to LDL.
Okay, now if this triglyceride is not controlled, is not brought to your levels which you would like to be, would you use a fenofibrate? Because that also increases a lot of side effects if you used with statins.
We have been acclimatized to use fenofibrate. It works and reduces. But we have another alternate available now, saroglitazar, which is quite a potent triglyceride reducing agent. And the side effect wise, it is said to be safer compared to fibrate, because all hepatotoxic side effects are not seen with this. And in fact, it is seen that it is quite effective, and it has been recommended also and approved by DCGI for NASH also. So this is another thing. Another advantage of saroglitazar is it has a very mild blood sugar lowering properties also, 0.3, 0.4. So compared to fenofibrate, saroglitazar is now, I think, being used more popularly, and it is more effective, and it has a multiple level of action. Because if you recall my presentation, I mentioned should we consider NASH as one of the pointers to handle, because this is the basic soil. If we are able to handle obesity, we are able to handle NASH, then possibly our patient will not test diabetes, hypertension or coronary artery disease. Yes, Dr. Andran.
Okay, thank you. Yes, thank you. So we'll go to Dr. Sharma. Dr. Sharma, now we know that hypoglycemic episodes are more common in patients with chronic kidney disease. So how do you treat these patients? What are your choice of anti-hypoglycemic agents in this particular patient so that you can avoid recurrent episodes of hypoglycemia?
Okay. So in CKD, there are two types of scenarios. Most of the patients are actually at increased risk of hypoglycemia, and their requirement are significant less because the insulin metabolism sites are one of the important sites is the kidney. So the requirement is less, not only of the sulfonylurea, but other agents, but at the same time of insulin also. But there is another group, although that is in the number of this particular group is small, but that group has insignificant increase in insulin resistance also. So in that particular group, you have to actually uptight it, or the requirement of insulin might be increased in that particular group. But in both groups, the chances of hypoglycemia are significantly more, because we know that in addition to the liver, the kidney is one of the site of gluconeogenesis, nearly 20-30% of glucose. So this defense is not available now. So these patients, we have to choose among those medications which are safe to be used in the kidney disease or CKD. At the same time, they have the less chances of hypoglycemia. Like the various DPP-4 inhibitors, they are safe. Up to the tune of GFR45 or so, we can use SGLT2 inhibitors also, and we have the data evidence in it. In the insulin, we have to keep the at least nearly 50% of the portion of total insulin in the form of basal insulins, because they have less chances of hypoglycemia in comparison to the regular insulin. But yes, despite these all modifications, we have to explain about the diabetic education part and how to manage and how to manage. That is really important, almost similar importance as modification.
Okay, thank you. So we'll come back to the last question now. So it's a common question. So we'll take short comments for all three of you. We'll start with Dr. Mohan. It's almost time to wrap up now. So the last question, Dr. Mohan, is that what is your take on the use of role of SGLT2 in heart failure with or without diabetes? So without diabetes, what is your take on that?
We now have the data from DAPA-HF study, which showed similar kind of 27% reduction in primary endpoint with DAPA in HFrEF patients who are extremely well treated with ACE inhibitor 95%, beta blockers 94%, MRA 71%, 35% patient on devices. You cannot treat heart failure patient better than this in your practice anyway. And despite that, you had a 26% reduction in primary endpoints in overall group and 27% non-diabetic. I, for one, not only the DCGI has approved, but we have been using this drug right from September onwards when the data first came out. I believe it will be a class 1 agent. It is game changer, and we are already finding big benefit. We have the data from DAPA-HF clearly show that it reduces NT-proBNP levels. The drug also improves the quality of life and, of course, all-cause mortality, which is the simple gold standard to find out if the drug is right or not, is reduced even in non-diabetes by about 17%. So I am absolutely convinced we are going the right way. It is an anti-failure drug. It actually started as an anti-diabetic drug, but is an anti-failure drug. And in practice, in real world, the benefit will be far bigger than what you saw in DAPA-HF study, because DAPA-HF was a controlled situation.
Thank you, Dr. Mohan. Thank you. Thank you very much. Dr. Shukla, your comments on the SGLT2 inhibitors in heart failure with diabetes.
They are a wonderful full category of drugs, and especially they are very important in stage 1 and stage 2. And this is one thing which has got a huge preventive value. I've been talking in terms of prevention right from beginning, and it is, I think, much more useful and much more cost effective for a country like India. So in diabetics, we have been seeing last couple of years that it is definitely oral. Because of SGLT2 inhibitor, I think we started learning more about heart failure. So this is a link. Because of DPP-4, we learned more about hypoglycemia, and because of SGLT2, we learned more about heart failure. And it has got a huge preventive value. I mean, if you DAPA-HF study is one, but before that, In diabetic, we have a lot of trials, EMPARA, CANVAS, REDENCE. And all these trials have categorically proved that they are very effective in type 1, stage 1 and stage 2. I mean, the word in ECHO, Dr. Mohan or Dr. Sharma can comment better, the diastolic dysfunction, which had no utility prior to that, it is said that diastolic dysfunction improves. I mean, a non-asymptomatic ECHO is totally normal, good ejection fraction, the ventricular wall is normal, only diastolic dysfunction, and this is said to have a very big role in terms. So it is a very nice medicine in terms of primary prevention as far as heart failure is concerned. Thank you.
Dr. Sharma, your final comments on this?
Yeah, actually, I think most of the things has already been covered, but this is for sure that not only with the TAPA-HF, but with the EMPARAG or the NVAS, we have seen that the hazard ratio was improved up to the tune of ranging from 20% to 30% in terms of heart failure. So this medicine, and in some discussions we used to this, say that these are actually the cardiologist medicine more than the endocrinologist medicine. So the same is true that these medications are having various pleiotropic effect, including cardiac benefits. So that has been proved by various landmark trials. So I'm also convinced with the particular entity that yes, these medications are really useful in the those populations where heart failure is there. And in not only in heart failure patient, but in CKD patient also. Because we know that in CKD patient, the chances of heart failure are definitely high. So in those diabetic where CKD is there, the heart failure chances are even. So in both of the groups, these SGLT2 inhibitors are actually working at heart, at kidney, and in terms of glycemic improvement also. So these are really excellent medications. This is the era of SGLT2 inhibitors, we can say that.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. I think it's time to wrap up the program now. We're coming to an end. We have about 2 hours of program discussion today, and why not? We have so much eminent, big panelist, over big panel of experts, both from cardiology and neurology. So we had a lot of discussion, a lot of questions were answered, important aspects, practical aspects were answered, both of you, of all three of you. So I would like to thank Dr. Mohan, Dr. Shukla, and also Dr. Sharma for your wonderful deliberations and patiently answering all our questions from us, from the audience. So I would also like to thank the IPCA technical team and for supporting the program. So thanks also the audience. We have 1,200 logins today. So a lot of people have logged in to watch this program on the Sunday evening. So thanks to all of you and also the audience. With that, I would like to say goodbye. And definitely we want to meet again in the future for with some different topic for some more stimulating discussions like this. Thank you very much and namaskar from
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks. Thank you.
Thanks.